Hello students, in this video we are going to learn about caloric value of carbohydrates, proteins and fats, and we are going to learn about digestive disorders. So first we are going to learn about caloric value of carbohydrates, proteins and fats. So we are obtaining the energy from the nutrients what we are taking along with the food materials. In those nutrients, 50% of energy we are obtaining from carbohydrates, and 15% of energy is obtained from proteins, and 35% of energy is obtained from fats. So we require about 400 to 500 grams of carbohydrates, 60 to 70 grams of fats and 65 to 75 grams of proteins per day. If you take the balanced diet, the balanced diet will differ from one person to another person based on their age, gender, level of physical activities and other conditions like pregnancy and lactation. So based on this, the nature of balanced diet will vary. So now we are going to see about the carbohydrates. So example for carbohydrates, sugar and starch. These carbohydrates are the major source of cellular fuel. So we are getting maximum amount of energy from carbohydrates. So mainly they provide energy, and the caloric value is about 4.1 calories per gram, and the physiological fuel value is about 4 kilocalorie per gram. And in the case of lipids, so example fats and derivatives of fats, so they are the best reserved food which is stored in our body in the form of adipose tissue. And mainly lipids are used for production of energy. The caloric value is about 9.45 kilocalorie, but the physiological fuel value is about 9 kilocalorie per gram. And in the case of proteins, the main source of amino acids are proteins. These proteins are required for growth and to repair the body cells. And mostly only certain amount of proteins are stored in the body, and large quantities are excreted in the form of nitrogenous waste. And the caloric value of protein is about 5.65 kilocalorie. The physiological fuel value is about 4 kilocalorie per gram. So according to Indian Council of Medical Research and World Health Organization, the daily requirement of protein for an average Indian is 1 gram per kilogram of body weight. So for example, if you have 50 kilogram, then daily you should take 50 grams of protein. Your body requires 50 grams of protein. Okay, now we are going to see about digestive system disorders and diseases. So nutritional and digestive disorders. Usually the digestive disorders caused because of bacterial and viral infection, and also because of parasitic worm infections. So this infection may cause inflammation on the inner lining of colon, that is called as colitis. The common symptoms of colitis are rectal bleeding, abdominal cramps and diarrhea. So next we are going to see about protein energy malnutrition, PEM. That means the protein deficiency diet in the early stage of children may lead to protein energy malnutrition. It is of two types. They are marasmus and kwashiorkor. In the case of kwashiorkor, the symptoms are dry skin, pot belly, edema. Edema means accumulation of fluid in the tissue space. So mainly the accumulation of fluid is found in legs and face. And stunted growth, changes in hair color, weakness and irritability. These are the symptoms of kwashiorkor. So next we are going to see about marasmus. Marasmus is an acute form of protein malnutrition. So here, this is caused due to diet with inadequate carbohydrate and protein. If a child's diet possesses inadequate carbohydrate and protein, it leads to marasmus. So what are the symptoms of marasmus? Diarrhea. Here the body becomes lean and weak. So that is called as emaciated. That means here the stored fat get reduced and muscle tissue also get reduced. So thereby it gives appearance with thin and folded skin. So these are the symptoms of marasmus. Then indigestion. So what do you mean by indigestion? Here the food is not properly digested. So because of that, it leads to the feeling of fullness of stomach. And also, this indigestion is caused due to inadequate enzyme secretion, NXT, and food poisoning, overeating, and spicy food. So these are the conditions which cause the indigestion. Then constipation. So here, what do you mean by constipation? Here the feces retain within the rectum. So this occurs because of irregular bowel movement, because of the irregular muscular contraction of the intestine. Okay, and mainly this constipation occurs due to poor intake of fiber in the diet, and lack of physical activity causes constipation. Next, vomiting. So vomiting is a reverse peristalsis, and here vomiting is caused because in order to eject out the harmful substance and a contaminated food which enter into the stomach, and this vomiting is controlled by vomit center, which is located in medulla oblongata, and vomiting will come after the feeling of nausea. So next disorder is jaundice. So here in the case of jaundice, liver is affected. So because of the defect in liver, it fails to break down hemoglobin and it fails to remove bile pigment from the blood. So because of this, the bile pigment get deposit in the eye and skin, thus it changes the color of the eye and skin into yellow. And jaundice is also caused due to hepatitis viral infection. Next, liver cirrhosis. So it is a chronic disease of liver. So because of the cirrhosis, so because of this disease, it leads to degeneration and destruction of liver cells. So that results in abnormal blood vessels and bile duct. So because of this, it leads to the formation of fibrosis. And this liver cirrhosis is also called as deserted liver or scarred liver. So mainly liver cirrhosis is caused due to infection, consumption of poison, malnutrition and alcoholism. So this is healthy liver and this is cirrhotic liver. Next we are going to see about gallstone. So if there is any alternation in the composition of bile, then it will cause the stone formation in the gallbladder. Here the stones are mostly in the form of crystallized cholesterol in the bile, and this stone causes obstruction in the cystic duct and hepatic duct, and also it blocks the hepatopancreatic duct. So this leads to pain, jaundice and pancreatitis. So these are the gallstones. See, this is the cystic duct. So it is blocking the cystic duct, and also it is blocking the bile duct. This is the bile duct, and also it is also blocking the hepatopancreatic duct. So thus it causes a severe pain. So next we are going to see about appendicitis. So what do you mean by appendicitis? It is the inflammation of vermiform appendix. This leads to severe abdominal pain. What is the treatment for appendicitis? The treatment involves removal of appendix by surgery. If the treatment is delayed, what will happen? This appendix may rupture. It will burst. Thereby it results in infection of the abdomen. So that condition is called as peritonitis. So this is the normal appendix. This is the inflamed appendix. So next we are going to see about hiatus hernia. So hiatus hernia are a structural abnormality. So during this superior part of the stomach, it will protrude slightly above the diaphragm. So this is the normal condition of the stomach. So in the case of hiatus hernia, so the upper part of the stomach get, this is the diaphragm. So the upper part of the stomach get protrude into this through the diaphragm. So what is the cause of this hiatus hernia? Means it is caused due to injury or any damage. Okay, that leads to weakening of muscle tissue. Okay, so when it will make the muscle tissue weaken, means by applying too much pressure on the muscles around the stomach. During this condition, heartburn is common. Why? Means the stomach contents travel back into the esophagus or even to the oral cavity, and this causes pain in the center of the chest due to eroding nature of the acidity. So next we are going to see about diarrhea. It is most common gastrointestinal disorder throughout the world. Mainly it is caused because of bacterial and viral infection through contaminated food and water. So because of the infection, the lining of the intestine is damaged by pathogens. So the colon is unable to absorb the fluid. So that, and also there will be abnormal frequency of bowel movement. Okay, so that will increases the liquidity of fecal discharge. That condition is called as diarrhea. So if diarrhea is not treated, it leads to dehydration. The treatment involves for diarrhea is oral hydration therapy. So what do you mean by oral hydration therapy? Means, so this involves drinking plenty of fluids. Okay, sipping small amount of water at a time to rehydrate the body. Next, peptic ulcer. Peptic ulcer refers to eroded area of the tissue lining in the stomach and duodenum. Usually this duodenal ulcer occurs in the people around the age group of 25 to 45 years. Gastric ulcer causes in the stomach. It is more common in the person who is above the age of 50 years. The major cause for peptic ulcer is because of bacterium Helicobacter pylori. And also other causes are, this is because of uncontrolled usage of aspirin or certain anti-inflammatory drugs. And also it is caused due to smoking, caffeine and psychological stress. Next we are going to see about obesity. So obesity is caused due to storage of excess body fat in adipose tissue. This obesity induces hypertension, atherosclerosis, it is a heart disease, and diabetes. This obesity is caused due to genetic base or by excess intake of food or because of any malfunctioning of endocrine, and also it is caused because of metabolic disorders. The degree of obesity is assessed by body mass index, BMI. A normal BMI range for adult is 19 to 25. If it is above 25, then we can consider the person is obese. So how can we find out the BMI of our body? Means BMI is equal to body weight in kilogram divided by the square of body height in meters. Take for an example, if a weight of a person is 50 kilogram and his height is about 160 centimeter, okay, then what is the BMI of that person? Means the weight of a person which is 50 kilogram, then the height of a person in meter. So it is given a centimeter, we have to convert that into meter. So you have to divide that with 100, so thus we get 1.6 meter. So square of the height of a person in meter, so 1.6 the whole square. Okay, so if we divide this, you will get 19.5. so for the height 160, the weight of the person is should be around 50 kilogram, then the person is normal. If it is less than this 19, then we can say that person is lean. If it is above 25, we can say that person is obese. Okay students, I hope you would have understood. Thank you students.